Welcome to another episode of Tech Society, a bi-weekly podcast that offers a cohesive picture of what's happening in the ever-changing world of technology and modern society. And now your hosts, Alex Dunmo and John Newman.
Sup techies, we have an extra special episode for you, as today we're speaking with Dagogo Altraide, better known as ColdFusion. Dagogo is a successful Australian YouTuber, entrepreneur, music producer, and published author. His YouTube channel, ColdFusion, is hugely popular and currently has over 2.8 million subscribers. ColdFusion videos have appeared everywhere, from time.com to museums, lecture halls, exhibitions. He has also partnered with TEDx and has worked with massive international brands such as Intel. Stay tuned as Dagogo shares with us his personal story, his experiences managing a massive YouTube channel and community, and his exciting plans for the future.
Yes, my name is Dagogo Altraide. I run the YouTube channel ColdFusion. So essentially what I do is I make mini documentaries on science, technology, business and history. So kind of like older style stuff, kind of like the Discovery Channel, all that kind of thing, but more up to date. So it's a longer form content kind of thing. And yeah, I'm an engineer by trade, but essentially decided that wasn't for me. So I decided to go into video production and here I am.
And you're also a musician.
I am a musician and producer, yes.
That's cool. When did you start doing ColdFusion?
So I started the channel like actually just uploading videos from like 2008 or 9, something like that. But that was just literally as a hobby as I was studying engineering. So it was stuff nothing to do with, you know, what I do now.
Yeah. Are those videos still up? Actually?
They are.
Cool.
But right. I would encourage going back and watching them. Yeah. So it was totally random stuff. Yeah. Some of it funny and just some stupid. And then I guess from 2013 to 2014 is when I started doing it a bit more seriously. Because essentially I was doing phone reviews at first. And then I kind of added more context to that. So essentially like the history behind certain things. And then I found that, you know, people were interested in that kind of thing and found it different. And then I did my first kind of documentary style thing on Google, just its history and whatever. Because in my free time, I would just research these stories because I was interested in it. And then people really responded positively to me putting that kind of stuff out there. Because I was like, when I was researching, I was like, this stuff is really interesting. I'm sure other people would be interested in finding out how these things came to be. And so that was, around 2013, 2014. And from that point, it kind of just became more of the documentary side of things.
I like your style has remained true as well. You haven't succumbed to that, what's the word, like frenetic YouTube.
A personality.
Yeah. You know, your head in the corner and like jump cuts and, you know, it's.
Yeah, I actually have a huge stance and problem against that. Like I said, like I feel that there was like a peak time for video content, like just in terms of the style and the way it was done, which I think was the late 80s and all of the 90s and up until the early 2000s. I think that was the period. But then as the internet came along, it became more about grabbing people's attention and
like music video style.
Yeah. And for me, it's just the content is king. Like if your content is worth sitting there and watching, like you don't have to do that kind of stuff. People will sit and watch through it. So yeah, I think a good example, because a lot of people say these days people don't like long form content, but a good example would be like Joe Rogan, for example. He has like 3-hour things and people watch the whole thing.
It. Yeah.
So
it
just has to be good. That's it.
I like that you've stayed true to that, which, because there must be moments where you're like, oh, if I did 8-minute videos, you know, like, oh, you know, the uptake. Like.
Yeah, exactly. And that's kind of like, you know, with things like TikTok and all of that, it's like getting even shorter and shorter. I'm like, man, this is not where I want to be. But like, I think it kind of, if you are interested in it and you have the passion for it, like it's not going to seem boring, like because you're passionate about what you're talking about. I think people can really sense that. So there wasn't really a need to shift for me.
And it means your fans are kind of more invested, right? Like they're on this journey with you rather than someone who's watched a cat video and then your videos come up and you know, you often find these drive-by people are more demanding than your actual loyal fans.
Well, on that, you've been trying to build a community as well, right, where people can actually participate.
Yeah, so that's still in the works. So I don't have good things to say about certain software companies. not you guys, but just like, so I've been trying to build this website and forum, and there's been delays after delays because it was kind of done outsourcing, and the coronavirus in the US has caused havoc. And it's, yeah, but that's, so basically what I'm planning to do is, because I have this, like, I guess, dedicated audience of people who may just be interested in science or tech, all the way to professionals, to, you know, people working in industry and that kind of thing. And that they all have the core value of being interested in this kind of field. So I want to bring these people together essentially in an online kind of chat room or forum to just discuss ideas and, like, just, you know, if it's future video topics, so there's more engagement and what people want to see next on the channel, or if it's just like general news and stuff. Yeah, I just really think that will be like a really cool thing to have.
I was about to say, is there a reason why you focused on forums, which is a type of really? Old yeah. school longer discussion technique,
I
as opposed
to, I miss forums.
Well, everyone jumps in Discord, right? And then they just kind of have quick forgettable chats. So is that why you've actually focused on a forum?
Well, it's because, like, from the messages I receive, like, some people write like massive paragraphs of like stuff that's going on in industry, and like, hey, like emails, like, hey, can you do this and that. It's like, if I could just put these people together, because like it's really good quality stuff that like people are writing to me with, and, you know, if they just had the avenue to actually express that to others, I think you know, it'll be pretty
so
awesome.
Is this mostly emails just flying in your inbox then?
Yeah, so like, so it could be Facebook messages, emails, LinkedIn, that kind of thing, like, yeah, just big long paragraphs.
And bringing that community together is actually, it will save you time as well. Because I think at a certain scale, right, you start getting too much information.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then again, you get like some ridiculous people who kind of want me to do like a video on something that's so obscure that, like, for example, there's been like two specific like Indian companies, like some steelmaker and like something else that, like, yeah, a bunch of Indians have been like, oh, you got to get on this. But I'm like, you know, that's like a small segment of the audience. I don't think like everyone will be interested. So I'm like, yeah, I don't think I can get on board with that.
And you have to be interested, right?
Yeah, of course.
But I get the feeling that
if a company comes in and starts asking for things, then it's suddenly not what you want to do.
It's not so much at the company. It's like just regular Indian citizens that think this company is the hottest thing since sliced bread. So it's not so much the company, but just like, it is still user demand for the topic, but it's very niche.
Although I feel if it was something you were very interested in, you would cover it anyway.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, like, that number one, you have to be interested, because I mean, you're the one who has to do the research and talk on something. And
Number two is what your viewers want to see. So it must be hard, because you have so many subscribers now, you can release some content, but it might not be what the rest of the viewers want to see.
Yeah.
So how do you please
people? And that's kind of, I guess, like, over time, as I've diversified in topics, that's kind of a thing where I'm starting to be like, hey, like, do I split this off into separate channels and just like get more staff on board to help with that kind of thing? So it has to start somewhere. I think in the future that's something I'll do in the next like 1 or 2 years. But as for now, it's kind of like a Venn diagram of like the stuff I'm interested in, the stuff that's viral, and the stuff the audience is interested in. And in that center is that golden little bit. But otherwise,
you've even kind of broached into politics, specifically US politics. That's brave.
And I think I'm trying to stay away from that as much as possible. I have a lot of things to say, and I think it's super, super interesting, my number one audience is the US, and right now they're just like cliffs apart. So it's, you know, anything I say, even if it's like straight down the middle, like, people kind of have this veil that they look through and they kind of take your words and twist it to mean I'm saying something else and I'm not.
I saw the video on Andrew Yang, and I'm a massive Andrew Yang fan. I'm really sad that he's not president. It kind of sucks that just doing that video on YouTube right now is an act of bravery.
No, that it's true.
It shouldn't be, right?
Yeah, it's like everything's hyper polarized, and I think, like, I don't know. I was just thinking about this a little while ago, and it kind of seems like this polarization is kind of like an echo effect of like cancel culture, or the other way around. Like, if you say the wrong thing, you kind of put off. But it's like everyone's like really entitled. It used to be people were entitled to their own opinions, but now it's kind of like
they're entitled to someone else's opinion.
No, no, they're entitled to their own reality. Like it's kind of like you know, this is the way it is, and like you know, there's a nothing
fact-free world.
Yeah, it's like
which kind of goes against the whole ColdFusion.
That's true.
Mission.
Yeah, really, right? Like I as hard like if we do get into politics and stuff like that, like if I ever will talk in that, I don't care. Like if it's left or right, up or down, it's kind of like I just want the truth, and that's what I want to like kind of portray, you know.
I think that should definitely be its own channel.
political stuff. Hey, maybe.
How did the name ColdFusion come about?
It has a long lineage. So it started, I guess, in primary school. So like Robot Wars was a big TV show. I don't know if you guys know that.
Of course.
It was great. UK-based TV show about people fighting robots. And I used to watch that religiously.
Just a quick deviation. We actually own the domain sumorobots.com.au.
Okay.
So that is a thing that we're trying to get. Happen here.
Isn't sumo robots those little
super fast ones.
Yeah, the Japanese ones. It happens in like 1 second. And
we've been trying to start our own league here in Perth. So
okay.
Just push the whole STEM education thing.
Oh, man. Yeah, you go for that. I really like that idea. But yeah, so it was a, you know, late 90s UK TV show. And I used to watch that a lot. And in primary school, we used to like actually create little... Well, actually, first we started off with paper ones. We had this like arena that we made out of cardboard. We had little rules that we had to follow. We made pavement like little paper robots, and we had to like leave our wrists on the table and flick. And we had like one move per round or whatever.
Yeah.
So my robot was called ColdFusion in that. And then eventually, like me and a mate, we both were like really into engineering and stuff, even at this age. So we kind of made electronic versions of these robots. So it was wired controllers and, you know, direct drive motors and stuff. And that robot was called ColdFusion. And then in high school, my band name was ColdFusion. And then I just decided to use this for the channel.
So it wasn't through the ages.
Yeah. Yeah. But the thing was, when I first started the channel, the name ColdFusion was already taken.
Oh.
And at that time, YouTube had a one channel per like
username
policy. So I put ColdFusion, so like a T. So it was like the ColdFusion stood for like the music side because it was from my band, and then the T was like for technology, but it was like way too complex for me to get, so it just looked like a spelling mistake.
I was going to ask, there's a few videos
called with a T. And then so after a while, I kind of just was like, oh, YouTube changed the policy, and then I was like, well, yeah, I'll just go back to ColdFusion, because people were Googling ColdFusion all the time. I could see like with the trends and stuff, there was a big video that I did, they'll type ColdFusion plus the like title of the video.
Oh, really?
So like, yeah, so it was like they were typing that anyway, so I might as well just change it to that. So yeah.
When you create all your videos and you do a lot of research, you mentioned a bit of burnout when you were doing it all by yourself, until recently when you had a large team. Now, what was that like? Is it just months and months of research for a video that people can consume in one sitting?
Yeah. So speaking of the burnout thing, it's kind of happening again because like I lost one member because he like decided to go and do his own thing, actually start his own YouTube channel. So it was like, he was like the primary guy that helped out with research. So I'm kind of am doing it all over again.
Right.
But so I can tell you firsthand right now what it's like. So essentially it's, I have to try and do a video every week. And depending on the topic of video, like the length of research can really vary. So it can start anywhere from like, say if it's a news item that came, like it's just like, say Elon Musk with this Starship? Yeah, the recent one.
Oh,
he just landed. That would be like, you know, 1 or 2 days, you know, research to turn around. That's not that long. But then something a bit longer, like say the Andrew Yang or like a, you know, big video like that, that could be like a month of work. So it's kind of like having these timelines of things spread out. So it's like every week there'll be something that's coming. So I'm working on 2 or 3 things at the same time, like all the time.
That must be like lots of lane switching then.
Yeah. But in a way it's good because you're not just, you know, getting bogged down in the one thing and you're kind of getting bored of it. But
yeah, that's true.
On the other hand, it's like, it is a lot to constantly have going. So in the future though, I'd like to have like a team like big enough that I can kind of step back a little bit and just be like more of that manager role and figuring out what works where.
A bit like John Oliver, who just kind of looks at the script and improves like ticks, the jokes. Yeah. And
something like that.
Was that a big decision to make at that point? Like, I'm ready to bring someone on?
Yeah, it was. Mainly because, you know, when you put out a video, it's such a work of, I guess, love and hard work, and you know every little intricate bit of it. It's like your baby, you know? And it's like when you put it out there, it's, you know, you did the best that you could and everything. But when you have someone else that comes in, you know, what if they don't research this properly, or you know, their, you know, tone isn't right or whatever. And it kind of, yeah, it kind of did happen a bit where someone would go away and research something, and then I'd kind of be like, do the research like 60% of it again, and be like, there's stuff that you missed. There's like really interesting things here that would have really grabbed the audience, but it wasn't mentioned, and things like that. So it is a bit of a learning process, and just finding the right people that will be able to do it properly, I guess.
Did that person kind of improve with time, or did you have to find someone else?
It was like a, I'm saying reverse U, but what am I thinking of? Like a
bell curve.
Yeah, bell curve. At the beginning, they weren't that great. Then they got better, and then they kind of just slacked off towards the end. So that's kind of how it went.
Yeah, it's pretty common. Do you pick local people, or you got a network?
He was local. I do have some specialists, so like for some finance stuff, like I'll hit up some guys in the UK. Well, one's in the UK, one's in India, do derivatives trading and all that kind of stuff. And do have another American guy who worked for like Goldman Sachs for 8 years and stuff.
Oh, wow.
But that's for a big video that I think it's going to be like maybe 45 minutes, my longest ever. He reckons that he's uncovered like this fraud in this certain derivative product, and yeah, it's really like interesting and like,
ooh, so expose,
kind of. Yeah, so like Bloomberg's touched on it before, but it's kind of like, you know, this guy's written, he was the first to give a complaint to the SEC about it, and they've like had a look at it, and looks like they're going to approve it, and yeah, it looks like legit. So it's in very early stages of talking, but yeah, it's a massive thing. But I'm not going to say much more about it.
Yeah, no, no, don't want to ruin it. Spoilers.
That's exciting.
So it's different people in different places. I think locally there's a bit of a advantage to doing that, obviously, because like you can sit down together and really like, so for example, the Theranos video, don't know if you guys have seen that.
Yeah.
So we worked together on that one, and it was literally like sitting down for like most of the day, this piece should come here, this switch this around. It was like real collaborative and worked really well. So there's something to that, to having someone local. Yeah, sometimes it's not always possible, but yeah.
It must be tempting to get someone on the other side of the planet, so you've got a 24-hour research team. That would be pretty effective.
Like there has been a few times where being an Australian time has saved me. When there's been some kind of deadline, it's like, oh, I've got an extra day.
Yeah, that's true. But,
yeah.
Can I ask, why have you bucked the trend of having your, like having you actually in the video?
Well, so I'm actually thinking of putting that at the end. So like, you know, when I'm just talking, thanks for watching, blah, 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 blah.
Oh, yep.
But then also maybe just reading some of the previous comments to get that bit of, but in all honesty, I don't know. Like, I'm just like, there's not really a need for it.
Yeah.
It's kind of like the content is king. Like, again, it's
content
just like,
should speak for itself.
Yeah. Like, I don't have to be enough. There. So.
Yeah. Oh, that makes sense.
Yeah.
Yeah. Do you ever get what we call imposter syndrome as you start building up all the information, and you just think to yourself, there must be, people must know this already, or you know, or do you find that you've landed on a gold mine and no one knows what's going on?
Well, I felt like most of the time I'm like, people must know, and sometimes there is things where, like for example, there's a few examples, like maybe when I was doing a video on the Laserdisc of the 1970s and stuff, or like the MP3 player of like there was like a concept for it in the 1970s.
Yeah.
But then like you get these people that come out of the woodwork that was like, hey, like I was there like in this time and that, and like, and it's like really interesting, but it's like they give a bit more nugget than, more of a nugget than you had, and it's like, there's no way I could have known that. It's like, this doesn't exist online. Yeah, in terms of imposter syndrome, sometimes I guess it's a thing, but I don't know, I try and always like add value, like try and think about things in a different way that makes it unique, if that makes sense.
What is your opinion on Bitcoin and the deflationary currency approach?
So I think it's okay, so with Bitcoin, it's good, like the idea of having 21 million Bitcoin, and it's like a set amount, and it's like you can't inflate it, can't print it or anything. I think that's good, but then you kind of have, one of the goals of money is to be like a medium of exchange. And I think Bitcoin at the moment anyway, like the mindset of most people that have it is more of an like an investment vehicle. So it's like,
it's a speculative.
Yeah, exactly. So you buy it so the price will go up so you can sell it like eventually later. If everyone's kind of hanging on to their Bitcoin and no one's really transacting it, then it kind of defeats one of those core purposes of what money is. But I think, you know, as far as, you know, the US government keeps printing money, and I don't know if you heard, but the Treasury Department got hacked 2 days ago by a foreign government, So there's
this
that.
Is the solar winds.
Yeah, the solar winds.
Oh, the supply chain attack.
Mm, yeah. Was it? Well, solar winds. It was like a security company that was like.
Well, so I was actually in a previous life a network administrator, and solar winds is used everywhere, and it is elevated software to manage your or monitor your network. And they managed to hack SolarWinds,
which was on everything, like Department of Justice,
all government organizations, Australia, United States, pretty much like everywhere will be running this software. Thankfully, to actually move to the next piece of this attack, you still had to do a lot of they had to do a lot of manual work. So it's not like everyone is, but everyone should be acting like they have been hacked.
Yeah, and the thing is, like, you know, they were sitting in there like for 6 months or something, like monitoring all the stuff. So it was
They managed to get around two-factor authentication for email servers, and the Russians have gotten in everywhere in the United States at the moment. Mm. It's interesting because mainstream media is like
silent.
And this is on the heels of the iPhone attack, which an attacker actually, a security researcher actually was able to hack an iPhone in the vicinity, control it completely, and create a wormable attack that would take over every single iPhone it ran into contact with.
I did not know that.
Yeah, so I'll send you the link.
Share it with you.
Yeah, please.
It's crazy.
It's worth a video.
Yeah, I think so.
He was able to, you know, puts this one iPhone down and he uses this airdrop attack. Takes over all of the iPhones around
it. Like to basically do whatever exploit he wanted.
And it controls the whole phone.
Right.
100%. Okay. So once you've taken over the phone, like it's yours. You can do whatever you want with it. Yeah. Scary. Very scary.
Wow. Yeah. Also, I don't know if you were aware of Google being down as well. Mm. Like just yesterday. I don't think that was a hack, but that was still pretty crazy.
It was pretty much the end of the world for me.
I wouldn't be surprised though if it was a response to SolarWinds, because I bet they're running
like
it in their networks.
Something. Yeah. Maybe.
So they've probably had to dramatically and quickly take down networks and investigate for, because they will be a target.
Yeah.
Yeah, scary times, and no one knows.
Yeah, it's just, I don't know. Like,
which is where you come in.
I think another thing that annoys me is like just the media these days. Like, it's a cop-out and everyone says blah, blah, blah. But it's really true. Like, they don't report anything. And like, if they do, it's like a 1 or 2 minute story. And like, it just isn't any depth. Or like, you end up more confused. If you didn't really know about like the backstory, you end up more confused coming out of that news story than you did going in. And it's like, you know, where's the space for like the real journalism? So
So is that what you believe ColdFusion's like true mission to be, is to kind of bring back journalism?
Well, so look, is it a journalistic agency or is it more like informative, or like, I'm not so sure myself.
It's definitely somewhere on the line.
But there is some parts of what I do that is, I would consider journalism. Mm-hmm. And in there is a gap and a need for that and a hunger that I can see.
You have 2.8 million subscribers, so. So the numbers speak for themselves.
Yeah. I guess.
So humble.
Sorry, I didn't mean to embarrass you. I mean,
it means that there is value there that you're bringing.
As I said, I think I see a hunger, and people do really want to just have good information that's clear, concise, and like, you know, tells you what's actually going on. But sorry, so going back to the Bitcoin argument.
Yep.
So whether it's whether it's printing money or the Treasury Department getting hacked, I think there's going to be less and less faith in just like institutions in general. And like, you know, even they're saying like, you know, we need to kind of start rethinking a lot of things. Like negative interest rates, for example, was just a textbook theory until like, you know, 10 years ago or whatever. And now everyone's, Australia's even like projecting to go down into that territory. And it's like,
I think we've hit almost zero by now.
We have almost zero.
Although the banks don't pass that on.
No, so. They don't. But essentially like we have a system that's so complex, so fragile, like it could break at any point. And it's like, you know, if you can have any means of getting your value out of the fiat system into something that's outside of the system, whether it's like cryptocurrency, whether it's like
gold
or whether it's, just other things. Like, I think that there'll be something to be said for that.
That is the point of the fiat system, is that you don't hold on to the cash. You go and invest in businesses.
You spend.
Because it runs, its value slowly drops.
And, so if you're sitting on it in cash, like you're not moneying. Correctly.
Moneying correctly.
Yeah.
But yeah, like I guess one of the overarching ideas that's kind of most people think is like, you know, we want people to spend. Like governments are saying like, if you like, it's bad to save, which I think is kind of backwards. Like I think that a good economy should have people saving, should have people like looking forward to the future. But when you like, you know, push interest rates down to zero and give away like lots of money, pretty much seeding inherent risks into the system. So people make stupid bets, and I don't know, that kind of like makes everything kind of shaky in my view.
So what prompts a new video? What do you have them like swimming in your head? Yeah, things you
right,
want to
right
do
right now? I got like five. Like,
but do you just like kind of live your life like normal when you're like eating a sandwich and suddenly like,
whoa. Light bulb moment.
So, shower thoughts.
In the shower, yeah.
Yeah, sometimes. But it comes from like different categories. So like if it's like a breaking news story, like literally it could be like, oh, this is cool. Mm. And then I go and look into it a bit and I'm like, oh, it's actually not that great. Or it's like, wow, this is cool. And then I kind of start from that. And Twitter is amazing. Like,
really?
Yeah. Like I think Twitter has got such a bad rep and is so misunderstood by everyone. Twitter is like for journalists, for researchers, for people that are interested in like getting knowledge. It's like an actual information.
So teach me how to Twitter.
The way I understand it, and I did do a video on how Twitter started and what it's actually meant for.
Yeah.
It's not a social network, so it's not really about connecting to people or that kind of thing, unfortunately. But it is more an informational network. So it's literally how information is disseminated is best done through Twitter. So, for example, if there is a breaking news story, like like, you know, Wall Street Journal or something will say it, and then like the tweets underneath it will be like commenting to other links on like different opinions on it or whatever. Yeah. It's good for what's happening now as well, very instant stuff. But yeah, like essentially if you follow good people, so you can have like, so I follow a bunch of AI researchers, for example, and they are obviously on the cutting edge of what's going on. They're posting up some papers and stuff like that. And then, you know, they'll like something from someone else who's also an AI researcher. I may not have them, but I get to see that stuff coming in. So it's like, you know, it's just this network of, and it's only as good as the people that you follow. So if you follow great experts, you get great stuff.
So I should stop following Kim Kardashian.
Unfortunately, that's not going to be your best bet. Well, unless you want to see, like, you know, what she's up to.
So Perth is isolated, and you've brought that up a few times in your videos. Does that make running the channel harder? Because you need to, like, just constantly grab secondhand information and pull it all together as opposed to being where it happens?
In a way it does. I imagine, yeah, unfortunately for Perth, there's like not much cool tech stuff happening here, really.
I beg to differ.
This is why tech
society. Unless you guys can show me. Well, you guys are cool. But, you know.
We created this podcast for that very purpose.
Yeah, exactly. One of the things we found is there's a lot of bubbles in Perth. And there's actually a lot of cool stuff happening in the bubbles, but they don't know how to let anyone else outside the bubble know.
Right.
And the bubbles Twitter, never apparently. Well, yeah, we don't use it, right?
Yeah, exactly. Right. There's no way to, because, you know, it's driven by mining, it's driven by property, and generally low tech. But the tech is there because there is a culture of engineering in Perth.
Well, just that's why you're an engineer, well, essentially, because your father was
an oil and gas engineer.
Yeah, exactly.
So there is that talent here. We are, like, I've always said, and it's wanky, I know, but Silicon Valley ended up being the tech center of the world because of all of their engineering talent that followed the defense industry mostly. But you had all these engineers in one place, and then their kids didn't want to do that, but they were still raised by engineers, which really, you know, sets the tone for a city. And I think Perth's like, that's almost there.
Yeah, maybe I should do some more digging into the local scene. I don't really seem to.
Before we continue this podcast, here's a message from our sponsor.
We believe that you can create art and beauty with technology. We think big. We move quietly. We are Ninja Software.
What about, just to diverge a little bit, you must... Yeah, 2.8 million subscribers, lots of views on your videos, and it's YouTube. So you must deal with trolls quite a lot, right?
Yeah.
How do you handle that?
Yeah, mostly ignore them. Yeah. Like, because I think the thing that annoys me the most is when you get a troll that is like, oh, you're wrong about this. And they're clearly wrong. Like, it's like...
Confidently incorrect.
Yeah, it's like, how can you be so... confident in something that you're not correct in. Like, for example, there was a video I did about Wi-Fi, the invention of Wi-Fi being an Australian invention, or was
it? CSIRO,
And I was saying that Wi-Fi, although most people think it stands for wireless fidelity, it actually doesn't stand for anything. And then I had a whole bunch of people saying like, oh, that's wrong. Like, it's wireless fidelity, blah, 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 blah. And then like, I literally got the quote, because I didn't put it in the video because I was like, yeah, that's what it was because I researched it. But then I got the quote from the guy, like when they came up with the name for Wi-Fi, saying Wi-Fi was just came up with a branding agency that we like, yeah, you know, whatever. It doesn't actually stand for anything. He said that in the quote. And then people were like, well, but retroactively, blah, blah, blah. People call it that. But it's like, that's not the guy who founded the name. It doesn't stand for that. So I don't know. It's just like he was super confident about that kind of thing. And it happens all the time. It's like, I think I've been fairly lucky. I haven't had anyone try and dox me or anything.
And a lot of the reason for that is probably because you do kind of take yourself out of your videos.
Yeah.
Right?
I'm not very it is personal, but it's not.
Yeah,
it's
no, but like, you're, like you said before, the content is king. You focus on the actual topic, and that's what speaks.
Yeah, exactly.
You don't like overly share your opinions or anything like that. It's an actual factual explanation of something that interests you.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, so I guess that has its positives in a way. So.
Yeah. But still YouTube, so you're still going to get
crazy YouTube comments.
That's it.
Just a while back, we were talking about, you know, technology and misinformation and stuff. Is that going to get worse over time as technology becomes more prevalent? Social media misinformation becomes stronger, or will tech kind of bring us back together as a society? What do you think?
It's a tricky one.
If you're anything like me, when you were 13, 14, you know, early days of the internet, you're like, this is going to change the world in such a good way. Everyone will be more intelligent, more informed. It's going to save the world. And now I'm just going to like, okay, opposite's happened. Yeah, it sucks.
Yeah.
That's
exactly true. Like, the internet literally on paper is like the greatest tool
that
we could all ever want. Like, all throughout human history, they would have killed for something like this.
Yeah.
And then it seemed good for a while. Mm. And then I think
the 90s were a golden time. Yeah. I feel.
Early 2000s. Yeah. Still
before broadband.
Yeah.
No.
Broadband made it all. Of broadband. Smartphones ruined the internet, I say. Mm. As the old man yelling at the crowd.
Yeah. I think there's something to be said for that. I think social media like literally hacked our brains to make the worst of people. So it's like things like that Facebook algorithms that were shown, they loved showing things that got people angry. Mm-hmm. Or like, you know, made them upset and were more likely to comment, and that actually had more engagement than just nice stories or whatever. So it kind of was like they were making money off making people mad. Mm. And then also social media has hooks as well. So it's like they want you to refresh pages and like get notifications and click just to keep you on. So it's like their software engineers versus our brains, and like they're going to win, obviously. So it's kind of like, you know, it's bringing out the worst in people and kind of shifting it a certain way. And then I guess everyone has the power to just be like, I don't want to do it. Like I don't have to play this game. But a lot of people, I don't know, their friends are on there and they kind of just want to argue. Like,
and that algorithm sometimes works in good ways, like with your videos. And because your videos are, you know, over 10 minutes, YouTube will, you're the kind of video they like to promote, because anything that keeps kind of someone stuck to the screen.
That is a good, I'm not just saying it biasly, that is a good use of it. But more so, like, I guess Facebook and things like Twitter as well. Mm. Like, it can get pretty bad. But like, I think Facebook's the worst offender. Like, it was literally shown that, you know.
Well, they know about it.
Yeah.
And then they hired psychologists to increase it.
Yeah. You know, exactly.
Google could argue that they created an algorithm that just tries to get people to watch more video. Okay. But Facebook actually went, no.
Let's make them angry.
Yeah. All these divisive groups, like, and they're easier to sell to. You know, so for example, it's a lot easier to sell bullets to Trump supporters.
Conspiracy theory groups.
So,
high value.
You keep them on your platform and you sell them guns and bullets. Mm. You know, like.
Yeah, it makes economic sense. Yeah.
Yeah.
As for the disinformation thing, I think it's a two way. I don't know. Like, I don't know if it's going to get easier or not, but it becomes tricky when you get like social media companies trying to like be the arbiters of truth, because you do have people there that will like to kind of sift through the information and try and like, you know, get a ruling on something. But then, you know, they may not be the experts in that field that actually knows what's going on. It's kind of, these are kind of edge cases, but it's like, there could be a problem there where, like you're saying, oh, this is false information when it isn't. Like, and the other argument would be just let people decide what they
free market
what they want to consume and everything, but then I guess it might just steer people off into a crazy deluded
I don't think they're making choices, you know. You sit there scrolling and it's easier than
reading.
Have you formed a bit of a tight-knit relationships with other YouTube channels that are more like, you know, akin to your content?
I have relationships with some, but I wouldn't say very tight-knit. Like, we just talk occasionally.
Mm. Yeah.
So I don't know if you know Jabrils. I don't know if you heard.
No. That sounds familiar, actually.
He's like this guy who does like funny. It's interesting because it's like a mix of like AI coding and just coding in general, but it's like comedy as well. So So I met him in Atlanta, and like we've been talking ever since, just occasionally, less, you know, just like mates or whatever.
Yeah.
Real Engineering. I don't know if you.
Yes.
Oh, that's a cool channel. Is that the ex-NASA guy?
I don't know if it's ex-NASA. He's Irish.
Oh, no, I'm thinking of someone else.
Oh, you're thinking of the guy that made that. The glitter bomb for the criminals. But yeah, the Real Engineering guy. Yeah, we chat occasionally. But these aren't like close-knit. Like, I just feel like, I'm far away from where, like, YouTubers in Perth is rare. But if they are YouTubers in Perth, they're doing totally different stuff. And it's like, but actually, speaking of which, How To Basic, I don't know if you know
guys.
So from Perth. Yeah, we chat as well a little bit, but I haven't caught up with him in person. We're yet to do that.
I'd be scared if an egg comes out. I'm like, I'm out of here.
When you create a video, just a quick question on that: is the process quite, because there's so much information coming from all sorts of sources? So, you know, do you have like special speed reading techniques, time boxing, cramming information in so that you can get it all done in time?
I haven't really thought about like, so I guess what I do is like I'd start with reading whatever, but then it would be just like a light skim. And if it's like what I'm thinking, it would like.
So you jump in a deep dive into the whole when you find something that really catches
Yeah. But and sometimes it would just be like, if I really know what the video is like going to be from the get-go, like I'd have a structure, like in dot points, and like, you know, just kind of fill those out with the different bits. But yeah, like essentially to begin with, it would just be like skimming like on a wide range, and then like the more it is in line with like, you know, what interests me and or what would add to the story or serve the story, then I go deeper.
Have you got a big wall with like strings attaching all the things?
Like the conspiracy.
Serial killers and, you know, joining it all up.
Unfortunately, I don't. I do have a whiteboard, but that's just things to do.
Fair enough.
Was there a change you made in the early days that you kind of look back and go, that was the moment that, you know, the channel took off or, you know, appealed to the algorithm? Like, can you... is anything identifiable, or did it just kind of happen in the background and then one day you looked at the subscriber count and you're like, whoa.
Yeah, it was very gradual, but I think the first turning point was like when I started doing more documentary style stuff rather than just phone reviews, because I think that was unique at the time. So it was kind of like there wasn't many other people doing that kind of thing, and I got really good feedback from people watching, so I was like, hey, I might just continue doing this kind of thing.
What was it like when you hit 1 million? I mean, that must have been
I don't think about it too much. It was cool. I was like, well, thanks, guys. Like, this, you know, there's a lot of people that really enjoy this stuff, so I'll keep going, you know?
Yeah. That's cool.
It's the ultimate validation for the work you do, I think, because it means people want to watch it.
Yeah.
And your content isn't tricky, clickbaity stuff. It's, you know, it's real.
It's not manipulating views.
You're not like, you know, 10 things you didn't know about Elon Musk. Yeah. You know, like, I mean, there probably is 10 things you didn't know about Elon Musk in there.
But it's not going to be like that. Yeah. Title like that. Yeah.
Yeah. Which totally would work, I'm sure.
Yeah, definitely.
Next video.
What's in store for ColdFusion 2021?
Yeah. So as I mentioned, I want to bring more staff on board, kind of grow that potential for making more videos.
And media also, empire.
Yes. Yeah. So I guess like it's my platform to spring off to the next step, which is I want to be like a company like Vox or Vice, essentially.
Ooh, yeah. That's so cool.
Just that kind of thing. So an entire media company is what I want to build, but just to do it in a way which is, brings value to a lot of people.
All right. Final question. Our final question, we always ask a whimsical question. I'm sure you're aware of wrestling, MMA, the fighters have their intro music. You know, so they come out to the audience, the lights go down, the fog machine starts, and their song that encapsulates their character who they are as a fighter. Please. What is your intro song?
Oh, man. Does it have to be MMA outlandish or like...
A recent guest said New Kid on the Block. You know, like, it can be anything. So.
Okay. That's one of the first songs that came into my head, but
yep.
The 1975, Love It If We Made It.
Nice.
Okay. It's a bit more energetic.
I know, that's a great choice. Thank Sweet. You so much, Dagogo.
Yeah, thanks. Awesome. That was very good. Pleasure.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You've made it to the end of another episode of Tech Society. Well, that was a great episode. I hope you enjoyed that as much as we enjoyed making it. And on this week in tech history, January 29, 1988, the computer game Tetris makes its first appearance in the United States as a PC game. The company that released the game was Spectrum Holobyte, which had dubious licensing rights to the game. When companies became interested in licensing Tetris for other platforms besides the PC, a series of events kicked off a long legal battle in which the big winner was eventually Nintendo, who used the game Tetris to drive sales of its new Game Boy platform. Make sure you hit us up on Twitter, @TechSociety, head over to the website, subscribe to the newsletter. Have a great weekend, everybody.